Hey friends, come to think of this. The world has become so competitive and giving birth to people we describe as movers and shakers. See how they excel in their craft and contribute to the development of their community and their society. Their stories are fascinating and inspiring. Their examples are worth emulating. Their successes are great. Here comes a platform that tells those stories with the people behind them coming on board to do so. On Board with Ernest Kanjo is that journey which ferries you into the lives of Africa's illustrious sons and daughters, at home and in the diaspora. The one-on-one top profile interview is every week on Apex One Radio. On Board with Ernest Kanjo, be Kanjo's next passenger.
Hello there, everyone, and welcome. This is On Board with Ernest Kanjo. Cameroon, affectionately known as Africa in miniature, has always had impressively talented people. In the days of yore, every discipline had some individuals whose talents created enormous impact on the country. If Roger Miller was the king of the number one sport, that is football, Manu Dibango was the hero in music. Scores of other talented musicians showed up as well. And if the Eric Changes, Charles Nungos, Bo Herberts, you name them, became heroes in journalism, Solomon Tamfo, for instance, was a heavyweight in acting. Keboma Langmian and others could be noticed as having excelled in stage drama. We may cite names and the areas in which these people excelled non-stop, but one thing we also noticed is that fewer people cut across disciplines. It was, to say the least, rare to find individuals who excelled in more than one, or to be fair enough, two disciplines. Apparently, that is not the case today. Modern-day Cameroon seems to have completely a different story to tell. Today, scores of young people display captivating skills in various disciplines. Surprisingly, they jack in several things, yet master them all. It is no longer news that there are countless Cameroonians who whip across sports, music, acting, writing, IT, you name them. While some are born with these multiple talents, scores of others have come to learn that acquiring knowledge and skills in a wide variety of areas pays more than otherwise. Some of these multi-talented and multidisciplinary Cameroonians have been very prominent, and their works have left no one indifferent. One of them is renowned movie actress Nsang Dilong. The actress, who is based in Douala, is also a model and a TV host par excellence. Dilong, who is currently shooting Samba, an upcoming Cameroonian telefilm, has done scores of movies and is generally known to be one of Cameroon's leading actresses. In the course of this radio ride, we shall discover the beauty queen side of her, as well as Nsang Dilong, the TV host. And it is this multi-talented Cameroonian actress On Board with Ernest Kanjo is receiving today. And while the Douala-based actress takes the main passenger seat, you are welcome to join us on this ride. This is On Board with Ernest Kanjo. Thank you.
me, homie, get a mongo. Me, we be memo, yakin' ya like it, pepon. Maybe my imunu, my home on memle. Balen, yeah, poor Boba, so back away.
This is On Board with Ernest Kanjo, broadcasting from Columbus, Ohio, United States of America. You're listening to Apex One Radio. And like I said, we are privileged to have the one and only Nsang Dilong, Cameroonian actress, who is based in Douala, but who is currently shooting a film in Limbe, that is Cameroon's seaside resort. And at this point in time, we are moving to Victoria, Cameroon, to welcome our main passenger on board this ride. Nsang Dilong, welcome.
Thank you, and thank you for having me.
How are you today?
I am wonderfully well and blessed. I'm okay.
Right. Now, Nsang Dilong, I understand you live in Douala, but you've been in Limbe for some time now and working on a film set, precisely Samba, which is an upcoming Cameroonian telefilm. How is it going on?
Samba is an amazing set, like most of the ones I've worked on. Mm. It's a beautiful experience, so much to learn, and yeah, it's going good.
Right. And I also understand that for the past couple of months, you've been very busy. I don't remember when we went for a whole month without noticing Nsang Dilong in a project. From The Rumble to Expression, now Samba, and perhaps many more. Tell me, how do you manage all of this? Don't you get exhausted at times?
Sometimes I do get tired. But like I said once, passion has a way of empowering you. You know, when you're doing something you love to do, when you're having fun while working, sometimes you don't even feel the pressure and then you get tired. That's the experience I'm having personally. So for me, I'm very okay. Yes, I'm very fine.
Mm. Okay. Well, we understand that you've been doing it for a while and you're getting used to it. Once again, Nsang Dilong, welcome on board this radio ride.
Thank you.
Mm, okay, so just catch your breath. We are going to be back with you in just a couple of seconds and the journey will continue.
Okay.
Javis Bowie for Laver. Confirm my conk to K. Chuba. Hey,
Beautiful folkloric piece there coming to you from Cameroon, that is in Central Africa. It's done by Chili, an up-and-coming Cameroonian artist. You're listening to On Board with NS Kanjo, coming to you from Apex One Radio. Don't go away.
Kanjo, a top-profile face-to-face interview that presents some of Africa's illustrious sons and daughters, making the continent proud. On Board with Ernest Kanjo, just on Apex One Radio. Get on board and be Kanjo's next passenger.
Get on board and be Kanjo's next passenger. And our current passenger is Cameroonian actress Zsang Dilong. She doubles as a TV host. And from Victoria, she now joins us once again. Zsang Dilong, welcome back.
Thank you, Ernest.
Okay. And so, Ernest Kanjo may know who Zsang Dilong is. Other Cameroonians who have been very keen about what is going on in the film industry should know you already. But there are scores of other Africans who are listeners of this station and, of course, this great radio right who haven't come across you yet. And this will be a golden opportunity for them to know Zsang Dilong. So, tell us, who is Zsang Dilong?
Zsang Dilong is I'm a first child from a family of four. I was born in a small village called Bukwango, right at the foot of Mount Cameroon.
Okay.
Zsang Dilong is an actress, a TV presenter, and a humanitarian. I am passionate about filmmaking and acting in particular, and as well as being part of activities intended to better the lives of the underprivileged.
Okay.
Yeah, so I'm Cameroonian and it's not one of that. So I think that's a brief summary of Zsang Dilong.
Right. Now, Zsang Dilong, I understand that several actors and filmmakers and even celebrities run foundations where they help the underprivileged. Is that the case with you?
Can you repeat your question, please?
Yes. I just wanted to find out if you run a foundation where you cater for the underprivileged.
Okay. Personally, I do not run the foundation, but I work with an NGO. No, I work with two NGOs and as well as individuals. For example, I work with Redemption Education Initiative.
All right.
I work with individuals. And then there are times where individuals want to really help out people and don't know how to go about it. So most of them reach me and I guide them, or they reach out to me with what they want to offer and I then allocate the stuff to
Right.
My things really need them. So I don't own a foundation yet, but maybe
someday soon. Okay. So tell us, where did you grow up and how was life when you were a young child?
I'm sure same question. Wow, it's a long back in my childhood. Okay. I'm making it special. I grew up sadly in Bukwango.
Okay.
Where I was born. Yeah, and then I moved to Bova, and then to Kumba. Bova is a small village just after Buya Town.
Okay.
Yeah. And then, well, this movement was due to the fact that my father was a civil servant, so the nature of his job, he passed from one place to another and stuff. Yeah, but my childhood was really interesting. This movement gave me new exposure. Yeah, but interesting. But I faced some difficulties, and one funny one, which I will share with you, was when I had to move and stay in Kumba. I had to stay with my aunt. Yeah, and I found it a bit difficult to integrate with total strangers at that point.
Okay.
And there were times when I actually went without food because I was very slow and very timid. And in my aunt's house, they had this little law where all the kids will sometimes eat from the same place. They might put food in the tray, and they're like, okay, three of you, you guys are eating here. So we had just boys in the house. So you know the way boys can eat, they would be like very fast. And they would eat less than 7 spoons in 1 minute, and I'll eat half the spoon. So sometimes I would go for days without food, and I'd be so quiet to do anything, or just so quiet and try. I kept losing weight, you know. So it was really difficult. One day my aunt had to notice and I had to eat on my own. So the child was really interesting, it was really fun.
Sangtilong, Cameroonian actress, born in Bukwango, a small village at the foot of Mount Cameroon, that is in the southwest region of Cameroon, Central Africa. This is On Board with Ernest Kanjo. And our main passenger is one of Cameroon's leading actresses. Sangtilong is her name. Now, tell me, how was your education? Could you just describe your educational background, at least from primary to high school?
Okay, I did my primary education partly in Bova and also in my village, Portobello. Yeah. And let me just emphasize, my village is an island, a very beautiful island. So someday, Ernest, when you visit Cameroon, you might want to visit my village.
Definitely.
So I did my primary education in these two places. I actually loved it because there was, you know, a diversity in simplicity, because there were really both Kotaba and Bova are very small villages, especially my village where there's no pipe water, there's no electricity, and being an island, if you want to go to school, you have to go by canoe, if you want to go to the market, it's by canoe, you want to go to the health center, it's by canoe, you want to even go to where the fresh water for drinking is by canoe, everything is by canoe, you know? So it was really beautiful for me, a beautiful experience. And then most of the children come from low income farmers, so all of that. And then secondary school was a bit different then, really exciting, because I had to move to a boarding school in Boya. That was PKS Boya, where I did my secondary school.
Right.
So it was a whole new experience, because I left the village where there was no light, no water, nothing. And then I go to a different environment where you have water, you have electricity, and then you get to meet people from diverse backgrounds, some from the high and mighty bones, others from and then I had to learn how to balance myself and my self-esteem in that kind of environment, yeah?
Right.
So, and then high school was in PHS Kumba, that's Presbyterian High School Kumba. Yeah, and it was almost the same thing like PCSS. That's for the fact that I was not so timid like when I was young. I became a bit of a noisemaker, a clown, I would say. You know, there was a time in school, I can remember in high school, a guy, all of my classmates walked up to me and he's like, long on my ear. But you're beautiful there, you know. But no boy can ask you out because the boy is bigger than himself. Because I was careless. I was just doing my thing. You know, you're in high school, it's where you carry yourself. Then Frank Long was the crazy one. I was just doing everything like for one student. And it was fun for me, but I was just having fun. But most of the guys in my class were like, oh God, can this girl stop abusing her life?
Right. So let us look at higher education. Where did you study and what did you read?
Okay. Firstly, for my university, I started in the University of Yaoundé too.
Okay.
For 2 years. But it was not really my thing, because the decision of me going to SOA to read law was purely as a result of misguided career orientation. But then as my passion for humanitarianism grew, I started to understand that sociology as a behavioral science would be very relevant in the careers and passions I was developing. So I had to abandon SOA and the law. And I moved to the University of Boya, where I read sociology and anthropology as my major. and I minored in computer science.
Sociology, anthropology ain't a minor in political science. How are all of these disciplines helping you in what you do today?
For me, sociology in particular, I can say I trained me to some sort of a behavior services. On a disciplinary psychology, I would say, I have gathered a mastery of how people think, what inspires their line of thinking, and how their line of thinking will cause them to respond to different circumstances. And this knowledge helps me to build good relationships with people, be a great team player and a confident booster to my peers, especially less so when I was a beauty queen, and as well as minimize the level of conflict around me. And looking at the part of the humanitarian side of me, it really helped me, or it's still helping me establish a good rapport with both the needy and the donors. And it also helps me to motivate and uplift the underprivileged and depressed persons whom I tend to encounter in the line of my job. So sociology has really helped me a lot, and I'm sure I'm going to do a master's in sociology, because it's really important.
Sandy Long, thank you for that vivid description of yourself and that great introduction, which has put us on the rails. And we'll be back with you in just a couple of seconds. And when we do, we shall be looking into you as a beauty queen.
You are listening to On Board with Ernest Kandjo, a top-profile face-to-face interview that presents some of Africa's illustrious sons and daughters, making the continent proud. On Board with Ernest Kandjo, just on Apex One Radio. Get on board and be Kanjo's next passenger.
And our current passenger is Sang Jilong, Cameroonian actress and TV host. Welcome back, Sang Jilong. Okay, so now, like I said earlier on, you were once a beauty queen and even won a beauty pageant. Could you tell us more about this?
Sure. In 2013, that should precisely be on the 14th of August. No, rather, in 2011, that should be on the 14th of August, 2011.
Okay.
I was crowned Miss West Africa Cameroon. Yeah. Prior to my crowning, I was just a girl who loved modeling. But then I was, and I loved taking pictures. So I always take funny, ugly pictures at that time I thought were, you know, classy. I put all over Facebook. Mm. And there's this photographer by name, Terry Joe Jessica.
Okay.
Yeah. He saw my pictures on Facebook and he was like, hey, it's like you love modeling. Are you a model? I'm like, yes, I just got into it. So he said, okay, I'll be in town. I would love to take photographs of you. I'm like, oh, okay. The next day I was there. And then he told me he's organizing a beauty pageant and I want to contest. I was like, amen. So I contested for it. Went for the audition. The first time I was not selected. I felt like my world was coming to standstill. So luckily, we had other opportunities to audition in Bamenda and Yaoundé. So I was not selected, and most of my friends were not selected, didn't even bother to go audition in other towns. But since I wanted it so badly, I left Boya and went to Yaoundé and audition. And luckily for me, I was selected, and then I went ahead to the finals. It was really challenging. We were seeing a voice, talented, beautiful young lady, and I was like, oh my God, do I stand the chance? But I wanted it so badly. I worked hard. I was learning in the process, taking correction from the judges. And at the end of the day, I was the winner. Yeah, so I was crowned Miss West Africa Cameroon. And then with the help of the Ministry of Culture, I went ahead to the Gambia, where I contested with Africa International. Well, I didn't get the crown as Miss West Africa International, but I was among the top five. And there it was another beautiful experience because we had maybe from over 18 countries.
Okay.
So I'll learn from different cultures, making new friends. So it was a great experience for me. And certainly that's where I would say my career as an actress really started. Yeah, the exposure I got from being a beauty queen molded me into what I am today.
Right. Now, tell us, the day you first won a crown as a beauty queen, how did you react?
Okay, here's what I'm saying, something funny. So, at that time, I wanted to win so badly. I was working so hard to watch it. So, I knew those who were my strong contenders. So I was like, okay. After maybe I work harder from this house, I was like, so I kept telling all the guests, I'm like, if I don't win this night, I'll just go by the beach, sit inside the water, cry. And I'm like,
so that's interesting.
When I was proud, I just started crying. The crying which I planned to cry if I didn't win, I started crying on stage. So my sister was there. She's like, stop crying, that's a big deal. I'm like, oh, okay, yes, it's true. So it was so real. I was like, oh my God, this is not happening. It was a beautiful moment for me.
Right.
So it was so great. I cried so hard and people were wondering if something was wrong.
Right.
They all tears of joy.
Now, DeLong, I would imagine that apart from physical beauty, there is some other thing that would have motivated you to get into modeling.
Well, I got interested in modeling. Oh, and before I forget, sorry, I have to interrupt you. I also contested for Miss Cameroon 2013.
Okay. That's good information.
Yeah, I contested for Miss Cameroon 2013, and I was runner-up. I didn't win, but I was a runner-up.
Okay.
So that was part of my Asian career. Okay. Yeah. So what was the question again, Mr. Interrupted, please?
Yes, what really motivated you to get into modeling, apart from just your physical build?
First and foremost, my physical attributes really motivate me at all.
Okay.
I just love taking pictures, and then I always watch America's Next Top Model, and I love the way the girls walk. So when, back in high school, what I always did, normally it was not really, it was forbidden to take shoes very high school to school. Sometimes I'll get a bit stubborn and I'll take shoes which are a bit higher. And, okay, this is the part of me which is serious, but anyway, it's who I am, so let me unveil my data secret. So I would take shoes which are a bit higher to school, and during prep, when everybody's sitting down, we just sit standing along on the corridor. So from way back, I love the way models walk and the way they gracefully and everything. So way back, it was in me. Maybe I didn't really realize it. So when I grew up, and let's say around 16, 17, that's when it's just the love, the way the girls walk and the way they always take pictures. I always wanted to be in front of the camera for some reason. I didn't just know. So that was my main motivation when it comes to modeling. That was just it, because when I was still naive and young, I didn't know much about life. But just me wanting to take pictures, me wanting to walk well on high heels and stuff. That was just it.
I understand that beauty queens are elected these days to carry out social projects. Now, during your reign as Miss Africa Cameroon, did you carry out some projects?
Yes. When I was Miss Africa Cameroon, I worked a lot with orphanages. Yes, at that point, I worked a lot with orphanages, especially in around in Bamayo area. Yes, because I was working with an orphanage called Caridor.
Right.
Caridor Orphanage, almost like the face of the orphanage. And so I helped a lot in the orphanages and other orphanages around there, and in the Southwest region. And also I worked a bit with Sajoka in the Northwest. It's a center for people with physically challenged people. So I worked a little bit with them. Yeah. So basically orphans and physically challenged people. But as I grew, after the Miss Cameroon experience, I now got actively involved with NGOs. So I go, the work I do for NGOs or with NGOs, I go to very remote villages. Basically, we sponsor orphans and less privileged kids from primary school to their university. So there are times where I even have to go on a bike. You know that in villages we don't have motorable roads. Sometimes I have to go on a bike in these villages. Sometimes I'm beaten by the rain, covered in dust. Sometimes it's really so difficult, but then so beautiful because, you know, just the fact that I can reach out to these kids, I give them hope, make them happy, make them smile, and that makes my life, that adds meaning to my life. So that's it. Hmm. And then with the other NGO I work with, we still give back. Each year we have a new project. Like last year, we basically gave free consultation to over 300 patients in Kumba, and then we performed three free eye surgeries. This year we are planning a different project. We are still trying to locate a particular village that has maybe a particular ailment that is plaguing the whole village, so we can see how we can come and maybe try to help out. So, okay.
Half an hour gone in this radio ride, engaged from Apex One. We are speaking with beauty queen, actress, humanitarian, and of course, TV host. Her name is Nsang Dilong. She is the main passenger. This is On Board with NS Kanjo. Catch your breath, Dilong. We'll be right back with you in just a couple of minutes.
Okay.
Show you what I'm worth.
is on board with NS Kanjo. We have Nsang Jilong, Cameroonian actress, as main passenger on this radio ride. She now joins us again from Limbe. Nsang Jilong, welcome back.
Thank you.
A while ago, off mic, you mentioned that your heartbeat towards Afrobeats, musically speaking. Tell us more about that. How come this relationship with Nsang Jilong and Afrobeat?
Well, firstly, I would say maybe because I'm a bit too African.
Okay.
Okay. Yeah, growing up in the village at a particular time in my life made me to be so attached to my roots. I love everything culture, everything tradition.
Right.
When it comes from dancing, everything. And most of our Afrobeat singers of late are going back to the roots. Most of them want to sing in their mother tongue, and that is, I love that. When I hear any artist sing in the mother tongue, I don't want to know what they are singing. I just start buying the CD, or if the song is, if I can download it or buy on iTunes, I just start buying. So that is why I just love Afrobeat, just because most of them sing in their mother tongue, and I love anybody who does that, because I'm just so African like that.
The very African actress Nsang Jilong, speaking there live from Limbe, Cameroon, where she is currently shooting Samba, an upcoming Cameroonian telefilm. She is the main passenger on board this radio ride. Okay, we'll be back with you, Nsang Jilong. Don't go away.
You are listening to On Board with Ernest Kanjo, a top-profile face-to-face interview that presents some of Africa's illustrious sons and daughters, making the continent proud. On Board with Ernest Kanjo, just on Apex One Radio. Get on board and be Kanjo's next passenger.
Okay, Nsang Jilong, tell us, I understand you are also a TV host. For how long have you been doing this?
My TV host career is quite it's quite new. I've been doing this for not up to for about 4 months now, I'll say. Yeah, just 4 months.
Okay.
It's a learning process for me. I have no formal education when it comes to TV hosting.
Okay.
But growing up, if you ask me the first thing I wanted to do, what I was doing, I was telling you I wanted to be a journalist.
Mm.
But for some reason I didn't do that in school, but being able to do what I do now to save it was just gives me the opportunity to do what I really want to do.
Mm.
And sooner than later, I intend to take formal lessons on it and better my craft when it comes to that aspect, because I'm still new. I learn every day.
Now, On Set is a specialized TV show that focuses on filmmaking in Cameroon, and it is broadcast on the Cameroon Radio and Television Corporation, CRTV. I guess that is the show you co-host.
The last statement
is that the show you host?
Yes, that is the show I host.
Okay. Tell us, how did you become one of the hosts of this show?
Okay, it's a bit funny. Okay, firstly, Stefan. Stefan is the main host. He has always been the main host of the program.
Okay.
So for a while, he kept bringing actresses on board, like on a guest host. So this week in my house, maybe Adetele will be the guest host. The next week, you can have Chris Icar. The next week, you can have food trekking, just like that.
Okay.
So there was a week when I had to co-host. I did it. And for some reason, I don't know, he called me back the second time, like, can you co-host again? I'm like, okay, that's fine. I love this, by the way.
Mm.
I co-hosted for the second time. The third time I did, and I've been doing that ever since. So we just have to travel.
Mm. So what exactly do you do on the show, and who are the kind of people you receive on it?
Basically, bring news that is happening in the cinema, world, especially from Nigeria, Ghana, and Cameroon. But we are planning to maybe broaden it to Kenya and other countries. For now, we are focused a little bit on Cameroon, Ghana, and Nigeria. But very soon, we have to start stretching and reaching out to other countries. And we definitely receive people who have something to do when it comes to filmmaking, be it a producer, a director, a costumer, makeup artist, actors, and actresses. Yeah, those are the kind of people we receive.
Now, 4 months on, how do you find the experience? Is this something you are liking?
I'm not just liking, I am loving. Because I love TV presenting as much as I love acting.
Mm.
That's the truth. But I'm passionate about both of them. So 4 months down, I'm looking forward to the next couple of years doing this. I love it.
Mm. And what has been the reaction from Cameroonians? What is the feedback you get from the public?
On my fan page, I receive a lot of messages from people coming on set. They're like, hey, on set, how are you? I'm like, okay, fine, thank you. Yeah, so normally in life, in real life, I'm very fast so far.
Mm.
It's something I'm working on. I've succeeded to work on it when it comes to acting. When I'm in front of the camera acting, I become conscious that, okay, you have to slow down. When I wear the shoes of a TV presenter, sometimes I get so carried away, I forget to control my speed.
Mm.
So these are some of the feedback I get. They're like, oh, you talk a bit too fast, maybe you can tone me down. Yeah, when I hear that, I'm like, okay, it's true. You're really right. So that's something I'm working on. But apart from that, they love it. Most people say, oh, we love the fact that you have natural hair. Oh my God, it's so beautiful.
Mm.
Some of them say, oh, love your makeup. Some of them say different stuff. And some of them are more appreciative of the fact that we bring the film industry in Cameroon to the limelight, because there are so many projects that happen that people don't even get to know. But because of on set, people are getting to know them. And most recently, we have brought on set to Biafra, where Cameroon happens to be one of our hosts as well. So right. In the past, most Cameroonian actors and actresses abroad, especially in the U.S., so then drew amazing stuff, but those back at home don't know anything of what's happening. But because of concept, to get to know those out there in the U.S., get to know what they are doing and the movies they do. So I think concept is a great platform, which is really appreciated by Cameroonians.
Right. And for Cameroonians and Africans living abroad, how can they get to watch this show?
Okay, CRTV is online. You can watch CRTV online. I'm sure I forgot from that link, but if you should just Google what CRTV online or something related to that, you're going to have a link on how to watch CRTV online.
So okay.
Catch up. A lot of people watch online.
Right.
That's what people do. Especially those in the U.S., those who have been interviewed on the show and stuff, they cannot watch it because they are able to watch it online. So,
and as a reminder, at what time does it come up in Cameroon?
On Saturdays at 7 p.m. And then a recap goes on at 11:30 a.m. on Monday.
Saturday, 7 p.m. and Monday, 11:30 a.m. for a rebroadcast. That is on set. So don't hesitate to watch that show and discover the other side of this Cameroonian actress who is the main passenger on board this radio ride. Once again, Sang Jilong, thank you for accepting this interview. Just stay with us. We'll be right back with you in just a couple of seconds.
Traditional Kaba music. I beg that rapper.
Na the woman you give me, papa. Na indies are the married damn soul.
Now wow.
I be the man where you give it, papa. Na indies are the married damn soul. So let's go a big celebration.
Go a big celebration.
Where we can eat and dance through the night. Oh.
Dance away.
Your son and daughter making a union. The vow we make
today
is for the rest of our life.
Oh, make a shake, oh,
just shake.
It's my day, oh,
it is your day.
My family's great, oh,
great.
We don't get trouble,
we don't complain,
no.
Nothing's gonna bring me down. Say, it is my time to wear the crown. Today's my lucky day. Today's my lucky day. Today's my lucky day.
Can you give me
basket with all friends. Just thank him up high for our blessings.
Peter Jericho in that beautiful one there titled Lucky Day, accompanying us on this radio ride with Sang Jilong, Cameroonian actress, as main passenger on board. This is Apex One Radio. We're broadcasting from Columbus, Ohio, United States of America. Let us go back to Victoria and welcome our main passenger on board. Jilong, welcome back.
Thank you.
Okay. I want us to get into the crux of the matter. You are known more as a movie actress, and you've been doing quite much, I must confess. So tell us, for how long have you been practicing this art?
For 2 years now.
For 2 years, you've been actively involved in acting.
Yes, I first started with my YouTube. I have my YouTube channel. You know, my passion for acting was so good. And at that time, let's say 2 years back, it was a bit difficult to, because I was still too young. So the projects were not coming up like every day.
Mm.
And I wanted to ask so badly. I just wanted to ask. So I was like, do I need to wait for maybe a producer or for an audition for me to be able to ask? I'm like, no, I cannot sit and wait for this. So I started doing my own trip. And I have like a set of them on my YouTube channel. So my trip, that's where people started taking me seriously as an actress, and I started getting roles like I've been doing everything good.
Right. And so you are currently shooting Samba, which is an upcoming Cameroonian telefilm. Tell us, how did you get on board this project?
Firstly, I think I was recommended from the few works I've done, and then I also attended the audition here in Limba.
Okay, and you were selected to be part of the cast.
Yes.
And what character are you playing in this upcoming series? And do you enjoy doing this role?
I'm playing the character Nuella, that is the female lead alongside Adekele.
Okay.
Yeah, Nuella is a fashion designer with a co-owner of a fashion label called Samba.
Mm.
That's going to be the title of the same series as well. Nuella is very hardworking, driven, passionate about fashion design, a go-getter, was married to, say, the wrong man, who always cheats on her, who left her on the altar for another woman. She has struggled in a relationship, but at the end of the day, she fights for her love, putting faith on them, love to death.
Now, I must say that Samba has a cream of Cameroonian actors, especially the ones who, you know, are loved by movie fans in that country. Tell me, what is your relationship with these other actors and even the crew members?
I've worked with, say, half of the actors on set.
Okay.
I've worked with, say, half of the crew. Those from my mates, some I've never worked with. But, you know, we all are driven by the same passion. We all are brought together for a particular reason. And when you know, it's a like-mind thing, we'll be the same way. So all of us are here for a particular reason or the same reason. So it's difficult, and it's easy to understand each other. It's easy to work together. Sometimes tempers may rise and so we know. Sometimes it's because of the pressure of the job. So we understand each other. Sometimes we have little fights, little troubles, but we come back together. Oh, sorry, and we get going. So my relationship with the cast and crew is amazing. We have a good working relationship, and we are building friendships. When we are not on set, you can see all laughing, cracking jokes, playing around. So we are building a family, the Samba family, I say.
Right. Before you came to the Samba set, you had just completed another gigantic project. I'm talking about the Rumble. But tell me, what is so remarkable about this current project?
I think that's the last one.
What is so remarkable about Samba?
Samba is a bit different because the character I'm playing, I've never played before. Yeah, in Rumble, I was maybe this the daughter of a minister, very wayward daughter, who brings parties and very crazy. And just before coming to Samba, I was doing expression, which is a bit different. And Samba, I'm a boss lady, having a very annoying assistant, and I always have to boss her around. I'm always having this very serious face. I have to carry myself like a boss all the time. It's something I've never done in my entire life. So it's a bit different, and I love it. I can't wait for me to. I love being a boss. It's just so good. You know, you give orders like, Jumi, come here. Clean this place. Take my handbag. You know, it's so cute. But apart from that, the crew, the level of professionalism here is just on different scales. And I want to say, I want to send a big shout out to the producer of Samba, Elon Brenda, who happens to be an actress as well. She has raised the bar, I would say. She has raised the bar. And I'm sure after Samba, any other filmmaker who wants to do a movie has to sit and prepare. Yeah, Samba is still a project.
All right. Now, so far, would you say that your performance is satisfactory?
I cannot say that to myself. I've put in my best. I've worked hard to make sure I give the character the life which the writer intended. And I cannot say for myself. All I can say is I've worked really hard to do my best. And now the director and those behind the camera and the audience, the judge, that's all I can say.
Right. Take us back to the Rumble. How did you get on this project?
For Rumble, from what I gathered, the producer needed somebody for my role, and maybe it was a bit challenging choosing from what he got during the auditions. I was not aware of the auditions, so I didn't ask him, but I was not aware. So the editor of Rumble was watching my speech, and the director and the producer of Rumble was with him. And he's like, who is this girl? And he said, I'm standing alone, because in my speech, I look a bit different because I'm acting this villager, this woman who's always looking so shabby, talkative, always quarreling and fighting around. So when you look at me and see me in real life, you might get a bit confused. So when the producer saw me, they were like, wow, I'm a good actress, but it's a bit worried because you Rumble up as a classic girl. That can just play there as a classic girl. So the editor just laughed because the producer had never met me before. So when I came on Rumble, when I was about to shoot my first scene, I came in, the producer was like, please, who are you? I'm like, oh my God, I'm Sam Dillon. He said, what? So, it was a bit funny because I didn't believe I could transform so easily. That's how basically my God made the role on Rumble.
Okay, and you also did Expression, which is quite recent. Tell us about it.
Yeah.
How did you get on board this one?
For Expression, I know the producer, I know one of the producers, and I know both of them. Yeah, they've seen my work. And so they approached me and said they have this project, and they gave the script to me and asked if I could handle it. The character I played in Expression is a bit similar to the character I played in my skit. Just that Expression, I had to be a 16-year-old, but in my skit, I'm a 25-year-old. So it's a bit similar because in Expression, I was a very crazy girl, wayward, always looking shabby, talkative, horrible makeup, horrible clothing, chewing gum all the time. I was just a horrible person. in a situation, and that character who is going to make you laugh and who is going to make you angry at the same time. You know, that character you love to hate, you just cannot make her. So, selfish.
And in expression, you work with one of Cameroon's frontline actresses, that is Solange Ijeka. Tell me, what was the experience working with her?
Yeah, that's the first time I'm working with Solange Ijeka. Oh my God, she's a great actress. She's an amazing actress. She acted as my, how can I put it? Okay. Anyway, she lost her daughter, and I showed up lying that I'm that daughter. So in a way, she acted as my mother briefly. Yeah, she's a great actress. She's humble, and she's so talented. Sometimes I will watch her up, and I will get so lost. And then she'll be like, "Long." I'm like, "Oh, sorry, sir." And sorry, you know, she's great, and she's so humble and so nice. I call her Auntie So. She's great, and I'm so happy I've been working with her on Samba as well. She'll be coming on board soon. So.
Wow. Okay, Nsanji Long, just catch your breath. We'll be right back with you in just a couple of minutes. This is On Board with NS Kanjo. You're listening to Apex One Radio.
Ils ont dit que cet amour n'aura pas de fruits. Mais cet amour est très fort, ils ne peuvent que parler. Elle est Bamélégué et je suis Ewondo. The only thing I want for tell you, baby, ma demeure.
Mina Ayou, Chuka, Dina Mina Ayou,
Chuka, Chuka,
toi et moi, la la la, toi et moi. Mina Ayou,
Chuka,
aujourd'hui Mina Ayou, toi et moi, la la la, toi et moi.
Ils ont dit que cet amour n'aura pas de fruits. Mais cet amour est très fort, ils ne peuvent que parler. Elle est à Oussa et je suis Douala. The only thing I want for you, baby, na toni wa.
Mina Ayou,
Chuka,
Dina Mina Ayou,
Chuka, Chuka,
toi et moi, la la la, toi et moi. Mina Ayou,
Chuka,
aujourd'hui Mina Ayou, toi et moi, la la la, toi et moi. Mina Ayou,
Chuka,
Dina Mina Ayou,
Chuka, Chuka,
toi et moi, la la la, toi et moi.
Me and You, beautiful piece there by Rhythms. Rhythms is accompanying Ernest and DeLong on this great radio ride. You're listening to On Board with Ernest Kanjo, coming to you from Apex One Radio. Zhang DeLong, welcome back.
Thank you, Ernest.
So, tell me, what makes DeLong a good actress? What are your strengths?
Ernest, don't
commit that
problem.
Go ahead.
That day they were high. Well, you know, the general qualities that a good actress is normally supposed to possess.
Right.
Yeah. You should be able to be believable.
Mm.
You should be real. And, yeah, acting is all about make-believe.
Mm.
And you should be able to drive home. People should be able to believe in the character that has been created for you. And you should be able to impact people. Like, people should look, watch you, and believe in what you're trying, and believe in the message you're trying to put across. So when it comes to that, I'm still a work in progress. The long is still a work in progress. I'm still new to this acting thing, and I'm ready to learn. So I don't know how good I am yet, but I don't see myself that good, because I'm not anywhere near where I want to be.
Mm.
Yes. So, if you ask me that question on how good I am, I don't have an answer yet.
But I understand that directors and producers are very good at telling truths, some of which are bitter. What have they been telling you?
I have this problem with blinking a lot. if they take me to Olympics for blinking, I'll win the prize. I'll win a gold medal. I can blink for Africa.
Right.
So that's some of the challenges I tend to face that I've been facing for a while. But just on the set of Samba, with the help, with the coaching of the director, Ina Duncan, I've been able to work on it, and I'll say I don't have that issue that much. So sometimes when they're shooting, the director will be like, he'll give a signal with his finger, just meant to be conscious of the fact that I shouldn't blink so much.
Right.
But sometimes when you are, let's say, having a deep conversation and you tend to blink a lot, it kills the emotions, it kills the moment, it makes it weak. So that's something I've been working on. And with the help of my co-actor, or the person acting my husband in Samba, that's Desmond White, he helped me a lot in coaching me on the blinking issue. And I'm so grateful, because with their help, I've fully worked on it. But so far, the time you ask the director, that was great. So the fact that they tell you that was great encourages you as well, and it helps me to want to do more and to even supersede what I'm doing so far. So I was just a work in progress, and the directors are very helpful. Even the crew, even my fellow actors, everybody is really helpful, and I'm really appreciative of that.
Geelong, could you just situate your ambitions in acting? 5, 10, 15 years from now, where do you expect to find yourself?
Okay, that's when it comes to just acting or filmmaking in general?
Yes, just acting.
Okay, just acting.
Mm.
I see myself being one of the household names in Africa, and why not in out of Africa?
Mm.
Yeah. I see myself winning many awards, and I see myself being nominated for Oscars and Grammys. Why not?
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
That's beautiful. Now,
yes.
Meanwhile, a lot of actors these days are beginning to dip their hands into their pocket, removing money and sponsoring productions. Many of them are becoming producers. Do you have that in mind as well?
Mm-hmm. Yes, I do. Yes. I would say I'm a producer in a small scale, because all my skits are being produced by me.
Okay.
I produce my skits by myself. But I look forward to producing a movie soon. Yeah, I don't know how soon that will be, because when I want to produce a movie, I don't just want to produce a movie because everyone is doing so. I want to produce a movie that is going to leave an impact in the next 50 years. I want to do a good movie, a movie that people will relate to, a movie that people are going to be able to still relate to 50 years down the road. So I need an amazing story. From then, I can start looking for amazing cast. So yes, I plan to produce a movie soon, but I'm not hurrying. I don't want to be in a hurry. I want to do it when the time is right. Yes.
When the time is ripe, she'll definitely do it and produce that kind of movie that will have an impact 50 years down the road. She's in no rush. Her name is Nsang Geelong, Cameroonian actress, speaking from Victoria, Cameroon, where she is currently shooting Samba, an upcoming Cameroonian telefilm. Nsang Geelong, just a few seconds. I'll be right back with you. And when I come back, it will be time for film politics. Are you ready?
Sure.
Okay.
You are listening to On Board with Ernest Kanjo, a top-profile face-to-face interview that presents some of Africa's illustrious sons and daughters, making the continent proud. On Board with Ernest Kanjo, just on Apex One Radio. Get on board and be Kanjo's next passenger.
Okay, we are back on board. So, Geelong, welcome back.
Thank you.
Now, I'm going to engage this phase of our ride with something really hard. I can also say quite strong. And the first question I'm going to ask you is this. Lawyers have their own problems. Journalists have their own issues. Teachers have the kind of problems they face. Now, you as an actress practicing the art in Cameroon, what specific problems do you face?
Personally, or maybe generally in the year of acting?
personally and generally?
Okay. Wow. Well, you know, the industry in Cameroon is still growing. So there are times where there are certain facilities that will be made available to us actresses to help us with our work. Some of those things are not made available maybe because the producers may be handicapped, having challenges in providing stuff like that. So it's going to be difficult for us because we have to take care of those stuff by ourselves. We have to spend our own money in taking care of things that are meant to be done by the producers. Yeah, and most of the times, especially when it comes to costuming, sometimes we have to do it seriously, and you have to say, 100 and something things, and you have to costume yourself. You can imagine how challenging that can be, right? Yeah, but thank God for Samba. Samba is, like I said, different. All that was being taken care of. So that's one of the challenges that I've been facing. The costume issue is really, a difficult one. Just imagine, you can't wear this particular costume on this movie project, and the next one you're seeing wearing it. It doesn't really fit well with me. So most of the time, you have to start buying, from even the money they pay you. So that's one of the challenges I face. And then generally, the Cameroonian industry still have issues when it comes to maybe uniting of one body. Yeah, you know, there are little infighting from time and again. But I thank God they are working on that. So I'm sure this 2016, that can be handled.
Okay. Right. Okay. Now, we understand that professional problems are solved by professional organizations, professional associations. We understand that transporters have syndicates, lawyers have have the bar, journalists have a lot of media associations, accountants do, and every other profession have their own, you know, association that looks into their problems. Now, do you subscribe to the opinion that a film industry should not have any association that guides its operation, and that it should only be people making films and marketing them?
No, I do not.
Okay. So,
an actor's guild, a producer's guild, director's guild, marketer's guild, all of that is really important. Because filmmaking is a big huge, and nobody can be an island. We need each other. The director's guild needs the producer's guild, the marketer's need the actor's. We all need each other to be able to have a good industry.
Okay.
So let's look at different countries, let's say Nigeria or even Ghana. They all have guilds. And it's helping to unify them, it's helping them to even make better movies and even have a greater impact like they are doing.
Okay.
So I don't subscribe to that at all.
So, in 2008, the Cameroon film industry, known by its acronym as CFI, is created, and it is still existing as we speak. How much do you know about it?
Yes, I know a lot about CFI. We have forums on WhatsApp, and all of us are there, so we follow from time to time. We talk about stuff, follow discussions. When something is happening to maybe an actor, maybe getting married, sick, death, the race and stuff like that, all of us know that workshop and we can assist when we can or in whatever way we can. So, yeah, I know a little bit about it.
Right. Was the idea of the creation of CFI a good one?
Of course. Like I said, this gift is important. It was a good one. It's a brilliant decision.
Okay. So, we have the National Actors Guild of Cameroon, known by its acronym NACAM. Are you a member?
Yeah. Not yet, but soon I'm going to register an actor.
Are you hoping to become a member?
Yes, like soon, yeah, as soon as possible.
Okay. And when you become a member of NACAM, what would you expect the guild to do as far as your problems are concerned?
Well, I just expect that some of the issues we face in the industry can maybe have a body that can help regulate them. Yeah, because right now everyone is just sitting in their own corner talking, oh, this is wrong, it's happening like this, wrong, it's happening like this, this is not happening right, this is not happening right. So I believe that NACAM should be able to come together or bring actors together under one roof so we can all maybe air our grievances or say what we think is not right or how we think we can contribute or bring our heads together to make the industry grow. Because most people have the idea that the Cameroon film industry is corrupt, that they have so many names, come wood, this wood, this wood, this. So they feel like they are not in unity and they just don't take up serious because of that. So I'm believing that NACAM is going to help tackle some of these issues, make people know, make Cameroonians in particular know that we are under a particular body and we are serious-minded people, and maybe make people value us more or respect us more. So I believe in a country able to handle stuff like this and maybe even help to coach young actors and actresses and how to carry themselves well in a way that they are going to get the respect they deserve as actors.
Right. Now, Geelong, are you and your colleagues sufficiently paid as actors?
I think so. I believe so.
Okay.
Because most of the times when they write about me, I'm being addressed as an actress. And yeah, I think.
But do you think that producers should do more, a little bit more, as far as paying actors is concerned?
Oh, Enes, I love you for this. First question. Come on. Okay, now I'm ready to discuss. Okay. Of course. Because I don't know. I'm sure some of them are going to listen and some of them might frown. But for these three people, I just have to say this. Firstly, most of the time, artists or actors are not being costumed. Most of the times on set, you don't have a hairstylist on set. The fan got this rough makeup artist all the time. You don't have a hairstylist on set. When you come on set, you have to take off your outfit, your shoes, your clothing. You have to take off your hair. If they don't pay you, they don't pay you well. How do they expect you to do all of this? Sometimes they don't pay you well. You see some people, when it comes to their costume, the costume doesn't match the character. Why? Because they don't pay you well. So they don't have enough to take care of yourself. Not to talk of fine costume that will match the role. Just imagine somebody has to play maybe a minister. And maybe you have just three suits in your wardrobe. So a minister has to wear the same suit all through the movie. That doesn't look, that doesn't sound, that doesn't appear convincing. Maybe you have to appear like maybe a woman with a boss, maybe. And maybe in your wardrobe, you have those jeans and t-shirts all over the place. You cannot provide costumes. So tell me, how does a boss maybe wear t-shirts and jeans to play a particular character? So I think it's time instead of considering a campaign of
right.
You know, you didn't say an actress, right? It motivates the person. The person feels value. It makes you even work better and even act well, more than you do if you just gave you chicken change. So I feel like it's about time. You know, most of the time, the producers, especially upcoming actors and actresses, they'll be like, you don't really pay, it's an opportunity for you to get popular and make yourself known. They have been hearing that for so long. I think it's about time to start taking it seriously. Because they just feel like, you know, so many people just afraid to ask. They feel like even if they don't pay you, if you say no, there'll be somebody else right behind you waiting to do it for free. So because of that, they don't take people for granted.
Right.
I'm so glad that most actresses are beginning to know their work. When they tell you what I deserve, you don't want to give them what they deserve. Because, bam, look for somebody else who would maybe take whatever field or rubbish you have to offer.
Right.
I just feel like, as much as we're ready to support each other and maybe understand the producers and collect maybe the little they have, but it's time you start stepping up their game.
It's
all fine. Because if you accept to be treated in a particular way forever, they might end up taking us for granted forever. So I, for one, the time is me, where if you don't pay me right, I'm sorry. Take your movie to somebody else. There are so many talented people who can do that for free. So I don't mind you. Go ahead.
However, DeLong, for business to be sustained, producers need to cover their cost of production. And for actors to be properly paid, they need to make good benefit. And we have a Cameroonian market that is very weak. Some people have even described it as non-existent. Now, do you subscribe to the idea that actors can help producers in making money out of every movie they take part in? That is, you go around and you sell, is it DVDs?
Okay, personally, that is possible. But with all humility, I don't think I really have the energy and the time to be hawking TV. But I can use my platform. Let's say when I was a beauty queen, at least I got some popularity. People know me. Through phone calls, I can make phone calls to people who can help share this TV. I can make phone calls to people who can buy the TV. Maybe a film is meant to be sold for maybe 1,000. I can have somebody buy that TV for 15,000 francs.
Right.
Yes, I can help in my own way to make this TV sold. Like I always tell any the producers of any movie I act in, I'm like, I'm going to do my best. Maybe at the end of the movie, I'll give you 200 copies or 400 copies and I'll bring you the money. So I'll make sure I get this sold out there. But to guarantee that I'm going to hawk CDs. I don't have that energy to do that.
Sang DeLong is her name. She is also a model. She is a humanitarian. She is a TV host, quite talented. She is the main passenger on board this radio ride. We'll be back with you in just a second.
Ernest Kanjo, a top profile face-to-face interview that presents some of Africa's illustrious sons and daughters, making the continent proud. On Board with Ernest Kanjo, just on Apex One Radio. Get on board and be Kanjo's next passenger.
Sang DeLong, you're welcome back.
Thank you.
Now, do you also subscribe to the opinion that there should be a census board in the Cameroonian film industry? Which means that before movies are shot, the scripts are looked into by a board, and even when they are shot, there is some scrutiny which is done before they are released.
Very important. Very, very important. Because one of the reasons why we are not taking it seriously is because anybody can just carry their phone and do a movie behind their toilet and then put out there like a movie under the umbrella of the Cameroonian film industry. Trust me, let's say if I'm maybe new to the whole to the industry, and I'm like, oh, I want to buy a Cameroonian movie, and the first one that I get is one funny thing shot in the backyard. How do you feel? Just, you know, the first impressions come. And I just like, wow, this is what people do in the Cameroonian industry. They just going to leave the city there and go and tell the others. People should forget. People should say they are doing movies. I so want to see today. Oh my God, I was so disappointed. No, just that one movie now just make all the other good movies just look bad. So I feel like, yeah, and some of the stories also. You know, a lot of people don't want to reach for these movies, only want to act in movies, but the stories are so weak. And a weak story is already a disaster.
Right.
So I feel like, yeah, the censorship board is very important. It's really, in fact, it's necessary.
There are scores of problems facing the Cameroonian film industry, but I would like you to select just one and tell us what you think can be done to address it urgently.
I think the first one is the market for our movie.
Okay.
That's one of the biggest issues we have right now. Yeah, to me, I think firstly we need cinema in Cameroon. That will go a long way to help. You know, for example, let me quote an example of Nigeria, or let's say Ghana. Let's say the movie is released, and since almost each city has a cinema, let's say 10 cities, all of them have cinemas. So what most of the actresses will do is, once the movie is released, they give, they send out, they make a press release or something, and they say, okay, this movie is going to be airing in this particular cinema on this day, this other cinema on this day. So the fans and movie lovers are aware. And they come and pay to watch these movies, and they start at present, which attracts the people more. So imagine if each cinema, let's say 1,000 people have to troop in, and they go and buy the CD. Just imagine, you can make the money you spend on the movie just through the cinema, because of those who are going to be buying and maybe during the grand premiere. So I think that due to the fact that you don't have cinemas in Cameroon, that alone is a very serious issue. Because if they want to do movies here, they have to look for maybe hotels and use their rooms in the hotels, boardrooms in the hotel to do the premieres. And then we do outdoor premieres, which are the outside of the hotel and stuff. And sometimes it's not the best. It's not really the best. So one, we need cinemas. Cinemas are going to create the market already. Because, firstly, our people in the country should be watching. That makes our actors known. Then also, listen, marketing this movie. I don't know for some reason, maybe Cameroonians are just beginning to believe in the industry. In the film industry of late. So in the past, you sell your CD, you can sell from January to December. Nobody's even asking you how far. Hmm. Yeah, because you didn't really believe in us. But right now, they're beginning to believe in the industry. So hopefully things will get better.
Hmm.
And I also feel maybe the Cameroon TV stations, the Cameroon TV stations should start believing in us too. Because you can imagine that the national TV will air a TV series from a different country on national TV. That we didn't like a lot. But thank God that officials that we're airing Cameroon TV series. They refuse to buy, even if they don't buy, they buy at a very cheap rate.
Mm.
And I also think if it's possible to try to limit some of the foreign channels that run on the cable network and try to incorporate more Cameroonian TV channels, which are going to show our movies, that's going to help as well. Yeah, for example, if you look at, let's say, Nigeria and other countries, look at African Magic. Yeah, it's true, African Magic shows a lot of few foreign movies from different countries, but most of the time they show a lot of Nigerian movies. That alone has created the market for them. With the short time, because a lot of people watch that particular channel.
Right.
But I feel if we can create a particular channel in Cameroon as well, that is known for showing our movies. Yeah, we have a few channels, but I'm sorry if anybody is going to feel excited, but some of these movies are really below standard. That's like you said, we need a censorship board, something like that to eliminate all these kind of movies.
Mm.
Yeah, to show me that out body to be seen on TV. Not all movies are really wanted to be out there. Some of them are meant to be watched in the living rooms and it should end there. So I think you need those kind of TV channels that are meant for, that are basically there to showcase our movies.
Mm.
And then maybe online, because most Cameroonians who are in the country always have the problem with watching movies. So let's say, like, what Iloko TV is doing, maybe we can start giving a movie to Iloko TV, or maybe a good Cameroonian can come up with our own kind of Iloko TV where our movies are going to be out there, so those abroad can pay to watch. That alone is also the market. So basically, the market issue and the cinema issue should be an issue, some of the issues I think that needs to be addressed or looked into.
For the length of time you've been in the industry, I would imagine that you've taken enough stock. Now, tell me, when you sit back and you watch Bad Angel on TV, when you watch The Rumble on TV, when you watch other recent Cameroonian productions, what do you have in mind? Would you say that Cameroon has moved a step forward? Could you just make that assessment to us?
Absolutely, absolutely, yes, absolutely. We are moving forward. The progress is very evident and tangible. Yeah, very, very. When I look at movies that were done 3 years ago, or even 2 years ago, and look at what we are doing now, you can see progress. And I'm so proud that I'm part of the Cameroon film industry.
Mm.
Yeah, I'm so happy to be part of it.
Now, from 3 years ago, you have just mentioned that there has been a lot of progress registered. Let us look at 5, 10, 15 years from now. Where do you expect to see this whole movement?
I think in 10 to 15 years, we should be able to do movies at the Hollywood standard from the image quality to the quality of the actors and everything involved. I think we can get there. For example, I watched the trailer of a recent movie called Tenacity. The movie is not yet out. When I watched that trailer, I just wrote on my diary, looking for the Tenacity. Every day I said the director. Because I called him direct on my direction. I'm still looking for Tenacity. And then there's also a pilot of a movie, Coffee for the Dead. I watched the other day. You know, that time when you watch a movie, you're going somewhere, you just stand for a while to watch and want to continue.
Right.
But then it becomes a difference when you watch a movie. You're going somewhere, you watch and then you look for a seat. That's the experience I had watching the pilot of Coffee for the Dead. So, you know that feeling when there's something made in Cameroon and it impresses you. I'm not so easily impressed, but if I can be impressed, then I'm very sure everybody out there can also be impressed. So I'm so happy with what's happening. Everybody's trying to take things a much higher. Everybody wants to be the best, and that's a good thing. Nobody wants to be where they were yesterday. Everybody's working hard. Everybody's working hard, and that's what we need in the industry.
Everybody is working hard. Sang Jilong, they're quite impressed with the current situation as far as the quality of production is concerned. She is the main passenger on board this radio ride. Sang Jilong, just have a respite. When we come back, we shall be negotiating the last bet, one stretch of this journey.
I'm
by USA-based Cameroonian musician Alexis E. And of course, you're listening to On Board with Ernest Kanjo. We have Sang Jilong, Cameroonian humanitarianist, actress, model, and of course, she is the main passenger on this radio ride. She'll be joining us in just a couple of seconds.
You are listening to On Board with Ernest Kanjo, a top-profile face-to-face interview that presents some of Africa's illustrious sons and daughters, making the continent proud. On Board with Ernest Kanjo, just on Apex One Radio. Get on board and be Kanjo's next passenger.
Make you just a die of heart. You will find someone who cares. My little story is about a guy who's called Samuel. My little story is about this man I used to call Samuel. Then I found that he was a cheat. I didn't know beneath his man lied a huge betrayal. I didn't know in this.
On board with NS Kanjo, we have Sang Jilong, who now joins us from Limbe, Cameroon. Welcome back, actress.
Thank you,
Emma. Okay, we are about to negotiate our last but one stretcher of this road. So, I would like us to do this game, which I always do with guests on this radio ride. I'm going to cite some names, and I would love you to say something about them. Are you ready for that?
Okay.
Okay. So let us begin with this gentleman who is today known as Cameroon's leading actors, whose performance has left no one indifferent. His name is Jeffrey Epule. Hello?
Yes, hello.
Yes, did you get me?
I didn't get a last sentence.
Ah, okay. So, I said I'm going to sign some names, then I would love you to say something about these people. Are you ready for that?
Okay.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Right. Let us begin with this gentleman who is a frontline actor in Cameroon and who has a very, very captivating performance on set. Everyone has his name on their lips in Cameroon these days. His name is Jeffrey Epule.
This is an involvement of a superstar. Yeah. When you see him, when you talk to him, when you watch him act, that's a superstar. That's what Jeffrey is.
Okay. Now, you just did a project with her before coming on board Samba. We mentioned her earlier on in this talk, but I would like you to come back and tell me something, you know, much more remarkable about Solange Jika.
Okay. Solange is the big sister. I call her aunt, Auntie Phil. Yeah, she's very kind and very warm. Yeah, I'm sorry that she gained that for the fact that she's a mother of two.
Mm.
Yeah, she's super talented as well. And she helped us to perform material.
Right.
Yeah, recently she visited Comics, the Cameroon International Music Festival, and I was there at the launch It was time for her to make her speak. The way she spoke, you know, she had so power, you know, class, and all of the language. She's an amazing person, I think.
Okay. Now, for quite a while now, she has been in the headlines. She's also a talented actress. But then she's a little bit different because, like someone put it, she has packaged herself so well and is very representative of whatever thing is of good quality. Her name is Cindy Emade.
Yeah. Cindy is... She's a beautiful soul. She's a very, very hard worker. She's a go-getter. And she's a great actor. She's a great talent. Yes. I've worked with her just once on Rumble. Yeah, well, we had to fight with our guy. Yeah, and I look forward to really working with her someday. She's a great person to work with. Makes your job easier.
It's just very nice. Right. So she is currently your acting mate in Samba. She has done a lot of projects as well, and a lot of people say she's an up and coming Cameroonian actress who is going to hold the country spellbound. Her name is Ade Kelly.
You know, there are times when you're on track acting alongside someone, and it's very rare for you to meet acting with somebody and then go back and sit in. It doesn't happen all the time. But Kelly is that kind of a lady. I've acted a few things with her, and I said, wow, how did she do that? I went back to my book, and I took down it. And I'll say, maybe next time I should remember how she did it. I will not copy exactly because I can't be her, but then the way she handled it from driving, so maybe I should take it and remember how to tackle when I'm faced with this situation.
Okay. right.
Wow, she is good. Very good.
Last but not the least on my list is this gentleman who has been described by some observers as master of the art. He's also a talented actor and everyone loves to watch him on set. His name is Desmond White.
I've acted with Desmond White once. And firstly, he was my senior in secondary school. He was just ahead of me. And since then, even as a uni, he has always been a big brother. And he has always, from the time I told him I love acting, he has always pushed me. He calls me little bird. And he's always there to coach me. I mentioned a while earlier on the blinking issues I had. He called me and coached me on that. He always coaches me, always tells me, okay. He's always there to encourage me. And working with him is always a pleasure because, like many others, he makes your job easy because he's not hard to ask. He's another great actor.
Right. Now, in Sang Jilong, you've worked with scores of other actors and technicians. Could you just mention a few who have kind of marked your career in one way or the other?
Missy Bell. Yeah. He has directed two projects I worked on. The first one was Sanga and Imama, yet to be released, and the second was Expression Red, yet to be released. A good movie director. I've worked with Del Menzo. Yeah, that's secondary. Because of Del Menzo. He's one of these few cinematographers who know what they are doing, who know they're around the work that they are doing. And I'm so happy. This is the second project I'm working with him. Samba, I'm working with him. I worked with him on a session as well. He's a great guy. And also currently working in Nigeria, but it's a big brother. Sometimes, I've been trying one, but it makes me really fine. So it's also beautiful working with always good. Do you have a okay? Every time you come to my room, I'm just like, it's fine. It's always in college. Oh, you did great things today. That was so great of you. You know, that just makes you want to work harder. So, those are the two of them. Oh, and before I forget, Table and Drink. Jay is an all-round filmmaker. He coaches me on every level. And when it comes to my scripts, he helps me a lot. And when it comes to even the acting, he helps me a lot. He has a great knowledge when it comes to the entire filmmaking stuff. And I'm so blessed to have him in particular. He's a friend, he's a brother, he's a coach, he's everything. Right now, he's listening to my interview. He's there with me all the way. He's that kind of person in my life. Just encouraged me. And the last person I won't forget, Tavis Zamar, is also a cinematographer and editor. An excellent guy. Very good.
Right. Okay, Sang Tilong, the last few seconds will lead us to the last bend of this great radio ride. So just relax. I'll be right back with you.
Sometimes I dey feel my heart dey go on. Bongolo bongolo, we go land na inside Honda. I'll take you to Ghana. Next flight na for Nigeria. Cameroon, now there we go stay. I go tell my mama, I go tell my papa. Na like, na like, na you, I want, na you, 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 I want to, na you, I want. You make me so gulo, you don't make my heart de bogolo. Hey, bene me deo. And mama baby, now for you I die yo. Shiriko kwe, no to blame me why yo. Get the danger son, monke vava baby yo. Bongolo bongolo, we go land na insa Honda. I'll take you to Ghana, next night na for Nigeria.
Mel B. Akwen there in that beautiful one titled Nayu. We are negotiating the last bend in this radio ride, whose main passenger is one of Cameroon's leading actresses, Sang Tilong, who has been with us throughout. And from Limbe, she now joins us once again. Welcome back, actress.
Thank you, Ernest.
Okay, so Tilong, we are about to conclude this ride. We are soon getting to our destination, and I would like us to have it in a lighter mood this time. I know you are a very busy person on set, be it on a TV set or on a film set. But then when you are not on set, when you are not doing what you do on a daily basis, what else could Sang Tilong be doing? What are your hobbies?
My hobbies, I love to cook. I love to read. I love to go shopping. And I watch movies a lot. Yes. So that's basically me. If I'm not watching movies, I'm reading, I'm cooking, or if you see me out of my house, then maybe I'm going shopping.
Now, I understand that it takes some hours to cook kwakoko, for instance, or even ekwang, and to some people, it could be really boring. But when you say you love to cook, what precisely do you love to cook?
Okay, just mention ekwang. Normally, I'm not a big fan of cocoyam.
Okay.
Because I had a fun experience with it in the past. So anything cocoyam, I don't really cook anything cocoyam. But I love cooking stuff like plantains and puffish, which is my
my traditional meal.
Okay.
I'll cook plantains and pufish. I'll cook a lot of hearty-cutting. Cook a lot of okra soup, which is my favorite. One of my favorite food, okra soup.
Mm.
I'll cook a lot of eru, goosey pudding, corn porridge, that's corn chaff, as you locally call it. A few stews once in a while.
Okay.
But I'm more of the traditional person. I'm always having things like okra soup, eru, vegetables, those kind of stuff.
Right. And you love to read. What kind of documents could you be caught reading?
I read a lot of books on how to build yourself, esteem. And like now, this morning I had a coaching session with my life coach. And I have this book, the new book I'm reading right now. Titled is Self-Markers, written by Philip McGraw. So I just read stuff that will build me to a better person when it comes to my confidence and my self-worth. Maybe interacting with people in public and stuff like that. I read a lot of books around that.
Now, you are also very keen on fashion. What kind of dress style do you admire?
Anything that has a touch of Ankara, anything that has a touch of Africanness. Anything that has a touch of Africanness in it. I'm a big fan.
Okay.
It should be different because I'm not the kind of person who really is so happy exposing the body. I always feel like it's really covered because I want to be on the street and my pastor calls me belong. I want to be in church. I should be able to run to go to church. So I always love to be properly dressed.
Right.
So just give me anything that has a bit of African touch in it and I'm so happy. I love a lot of fans when it comes to in those days, we used to call them apaga. I don't know if you were born by then.
Oh, of course.
Yeah, I know this very plaid pants. Yeah, I love those. I love black hair. I always like to dress in the bossy way, like a boss. Always looking a bit serious, but yeah, that's me. But just give me something else because of Africanness in it, and I'm very glad. I'm so glad that of late most African fashion designers are beginning to incorporate African fabrics a lot in their designs.
Right.
Like on the set of Samba, for those who love to watch Samba, which I'm sure most of you will, if you see the way we are dressed on Samba, everything is African. Everything is so stylish, but it's African.
Is that
so the African
is that, Samba? Is that the Samba attitude?
That is Samba.
Okay.
Sorry, Samba.
Okay. And do you have any color preference?
Yes, I go for white, I go for purple, I go for red and black.
Wow. And have you ever thought that you could consider fashion designing?
A friend mentioned that to me a few days ago. I don't think so. My passion doesn't even lead me to that direction. I don't like doing things tried by error. I want to do something I know I'm passionate about and which I think I will excel in.
Right.
But if you put me in fashion design, let me say it in our prison, I will carry class.
Okay, now, Sang Jilong, there is this young girl who has been listening to us from Douala in Cameroon, Limbe, Boya Bamenda, Ndob, and you name them, and who has been inspired by everything you have said, and she would love to have the same achievements like you. What advice would you have for her?
Believe in yourself.
Yes.
Go for what you believe in. Work hard. Don't ever stop working, no matter how much you achieve. Don't let achievement cloud the sense of resume. Don't be all about the process. Be about the work. So keep working hard. Keep trying to make yourself better than you were yesterday. Believe in yourself to the maximum. and go for what you want, and don't forget to always pray. Pray, pray, pray all the way and believe in God.
Pray, pray, pray and believe in God. The voice of Nsang Dilonde running off this radio talk. We've come to our final destination. Nsang Dilonde, we want to thank you so much. How did you find the conversation?
The last thing you said, please.
How did you find this conversation? Hello? Yes, I'm getting you. How did you find our conversation?
Okay, this is the most recent interview I've had in a while. There are so many things I've shared with you that I've never shared in an interview before. So I'm really happy I was able to do this. And thank you for bringing me on board. This is just maybe a proof that the little work I'm doing in my own small corner is being noticed. And I'm honored, I would say. I'm very honored.
Okay, Nsang Dilonde, we want to thank you so much. We want to wish you all the best. You are one of those who have contributed enormously to the development of the Cameroonian film sector. And we hope to have you back on Apex One Radio some other time.
Okay, I'm looking forward to that thing.
Right, that is how we switch off the engine of this locomotive. Thanking all of you for accompanying us on this great radio ride. And on behalf of the entire Apex One radio team, I want to thank everybody. I've been Ernest Kanjo, the driver. And of course, this interview was produced by Maxel Adik from our studio in Valsut, Switzerland. May God bless you. Bye for now.
Hey friends, come to think of this, the world has become so competitive and giving birth to people we describe as movers and shakers. See how they excel in their craft and contribute to the development of their community and their society. Their stories are fascinating and inspiring. Their examples are worth emulating. Their successes are great. Here comes a platform that tells those stories with the people behind them coming on board to do so. On Board with Ernest Kanjo is that journey which ferries you into the lives of Africa's illustrious sons and daughters, at home and in the diaspora. The one-on-one top profile interview is every week on Apex One Radio. On Board with Ernest Kanjo, be Kanjo's next passenger.
Alphabet Records.
Nyango eh, oh eh.
Salatiel on the beat.
I go do anything for you. Eh, my baby, no cry, oh. Baby, now you be my chuchule. Do it now for you. I go cut my dada, baby. Oh, I know say now better no day, but everything I go share it. Now only you I go come on there. I go tackle, we no go fare. Call me anytime I go dede. Bad fashion I go throw it. I go pamper you, you no go pleure. We go deliver, eh. Dudu oh, it go better. Shushu oh, it go better. Kuku oh, it go better. Mama oh, it go better. My baby oh, it go better. Nunu oh, it go better. Nyango eh. Go better, Sherry Coco. If anybody men and say you do do, I go sample them now for line. I go fire them on me to do. Just with your love, girl, I don't belly fool. To every other girl, I pray fool. You did make me dance at a la cool. It be like you used juju, huh? I know say now better no day, but everything I go share it. Now only you I go come on day. I go tackle, we no go fire. Call me anywhere, I must stay there. Bad fashion I go throw it. I go pamper you, you no go blow it. We go deliver. Ego better, shushu oh, ego better, kuku oh, ego better, mama oh, ego better, my baby oh.
Hey friends, come to think of this, the world has become so competitive and giving birth to people we describe as movers and shakers. See how they excel in their craft and contribute to the development of their community and their society. Their stories are fascinating and inspiring. Their examples are worth emulating. Their successes are great. Here comes a platform that tells those stories with the people behind them coming on board to do so. On Board with Ernest Kanjo is that journey which ferries you into the lives of Africa's illustrious sons and daughters, at home and in the diaspora. The one-on-one top profile interview is every week on Apex One Radio. On Board with Ernest Kanjo, be Kanjo's next passenger.
Hey, we be memo. Yeah, can you like it?
family suffer for farm before send a picking for Sokolo.